On this episode of Nacho Mama's Math, we cover function basics, specifically domain, arithmetic, and basic graphing. We have to start with the definition of a function. There are several accepted definitions of what a function is, so context matters. Your instructor will introduce the definition of function most appropriate for their course, so make sure to ask them if it is not clear. Googling the word function will result in a mixture of millions of different instructors' takes on the definition and colloquial usages of the word, and will be very confusing. Here are three common definitions. First, a relation that sends every input to a single output. Many instructors, myself included, will say a map as a synonym for relation because it fits in with the story of a function taking in inputs and putting out outputs. Another common definition is a relation that pairs every element in the set of inputs with a single element in the set of outputs. So, if 1, 2 is a point, then 1, negative 2 cannot be a point because 1 is already paired with 2. The second definition is just a fancier way of saying our first definition. The last definition is the definition in Stitz and Zeager PreCalculus text. Verbatim, it reads, "A relation in which each x-coordinate is matched with only one y-coordinate is said to describe y as a function of x." The last definition is very well suited to understanding functions in the context of graphing. My personal favorite definition is the first. A function is a relation, aka map, that sends every input to a single output. While succinct, the wording here needs to be clarified. This does not mean that every input must get sent to the same output. The easiest way to understand this property is with a visual test. The test tells us whether a relation, aka a graphed curve, is a function is with the vertical line test. We conduct this test by dragging a vertical line across the curve from left to right. That vertical line, when it is stopped at a value such as x equals negative 6, as it is in the picture, is checking how many outputs on our red graph are being matched with input negative 6. We can see only one intersection at the point, negative 6, 0.4. This means that for negative 6, the only output is 0.4. This curve passes at x equals negative 6. We must make sure it passes at all x values, so we drag the line left to right and check. If your function has arrows to indicate that the pattern of the curve continues, you must imagine dragging the line beyond just the portion you can see. The graph that is shown was generated on the computer. It does not have arrows, but computers never add the arrows, so it is implied that this curve does continue on. In any event, this function never intersects more than once, and so it passes the vertical line test, and we can say it is a function. Let's see a relation that doesn't pass. As we drag our vertical line across the circle, we see that rather quickly it intersects the circle twice. We can stop dragging the line across and conclude this relation is not a function as it fails the test. Going back to the definition, this relation is not a function because, for example, we see that the input negative 2 was sent to two different outputs, approximately 2.4 and negative 2.4. In fact, there are so many x values that cause this relation to fail that we can't even begin to sit here and list them all. That's okay. When you explain why a relation is not a function, you only need to note that it fails for just one x value. Let's make sure that we are all on the same page with reading graphs of functions. We saw with the vertical line test that the graph shown below was a function. So let's practice finding some outputs on this graph. This prompt asks us to approximate the outputs f of 1, f of negative 1, f of 2, and f of negative 2. This means we are looking for the outputs that go with inputs 1, negative 1, 2, and negative 2. As you recall from algebra, a graph of a function has input values plotted as the x-coordinate and outputs plotted as the y-coordinate. So the x-axis represents the input value and the y-axis represents the outputs. So to find the output that goes with input x equals 1, we find the point that has x-coordinate 1. We look at the scale of our axes and see that each grid represents 0.5. So it looks like it's the point 1.8. Thus, f of 1 is 0.8. We repeat this process for x equals negative 1 and see the point negative 1, negative 0.8. Thus, f of negative 1 is negative 0.8. Now we look for f of 2. Looking for the point that goes with x equals 2, We see that it's about 0.8. So f of 2 equals 0.8. You try to find f of negative 2. That's right, it looks like f of negative 2 is negative 0.8. If you are a perfectionist, you may be bothered by looking for a point that doesn't perfectly line up with a whole number. It's okay if we're a little off because we were specifically asked to approximate. That's the beauty of having a formula for outputs. It removes this guesswork. Let's look at what a function looks like when we have just a formula to describe it. The most common notation you will see for a function are the three functions f of x, g of x, and h of x. Those formulas are just randomly chosen, but the titles I have chosen to describe them are the three most common titles for a function. The first formula looks like f parentheses x equals 3x minus 10. To verbalize this, we say f of x. We know we are talking about functions, so the parentheses no longer means times, as they may mean in another setting. In fact, now that you're in advanced math classes, when you see f of x, g of x, and h of x written in a textbook, it will always be a function. That's the convention of our notation. The portion to the right of the equal sign is the formula for the outputs. From algebra, you might remember plugging in an x value to find the output. This formula is what you plug into. The x is serving as a placeholder for any input you want. If you wanted to use another placeholder, like c, you would call your function f of c equals 3c minus 10. But at the end of the day, we would both be talking about the same function with the same graph and input-output values. It's just a style choice. We will practice evaluating a function formula for a certain input in a little bit, but first let's cover the notation that describes arithmetic of functions. Let's say we have two functions whose formulas we know. Call them f and g. If we add, subtract, multiply, and divide f and g, we will get another function by doing function arithmetic. We give those kinds of functions a name that comes from their generating functions. They are f plus g of x, f minus g of x, f times g of x, and f over g of x. The shorthand for the name tells you how to compute the outputs. So here's how we would actually compute them. For f plus g of x, we add the outputs and compute by doing f of x plus g of x. For f minus g of x, we subtract the outputs and compute by doing f of x minus g of x. For f times g of x, we multiply the outputs by doing f of x times g of x. For f over g of x, we divide the outputs by doing f of x divided by g of x. Side note, in order for f over g to work, g of x cannot equal 0. That means we can't compute if we get output value 0 from g. Whew! Done with the notation. Let's work on some examples. First example, let f of x equal 3x minus 10, g of x equals the square root of x minus 1, and h of x equals 3x squared plus x. Given the formulas for f, g, and h below, compute the following indicated outputs. We see that for this first problem, the function we are working with is f plus g. The input we are working with is 2. This means that we are looking for the output that goes with 2 when we plug it into the f plus g function. The easiest way to compute this is to compute f of 2 plus g of 2. To compute f of 2, we plug 2 into our formula for f in place of x. We get 3 times 2 minus 10. Following PEMDAS, our order of operations, we get negative 4. To compute g of 2, we plug 2 into our formula for g in place of x. We first simplify the argument of our square root. 2 minus 1 is 1, and then we take the square root. The square root of 1 is 1, so g of 2 equals 1. Now to get f plus g of 2, we add the negative 4 to the 1, and we get negative 3. So f plus g of 2 is negative 3. On to the next example. We see that we are looking at the function f times h, and we need to compute the output that goes with input negative 2. To do this, we will plug in negative 2 to the f function and h function and multiply the two resulting outputs. First, we compute f of negative 2. Go ahead and give this a try. And we get negative 16. Next, we compute h of negative 2. Be careful and follow PEMDAS, the order of operations. The exponent must come first, so we get 3 times 4 plus negative 2, which gives us 10. To find f times h of negative 2, we multiply the negative 16 and the 10 to give us negative 160. Last example. For this one, I'm going to turn up the heat on you. We are going to tackle a common misconception with the function notation here. You can probably tell we are computing f over g of x plus a. So we will do this by separately computing f of x plus a and g of x plus a and dividing them. Pay attention to where the plus a is at. It's inside the parentheses, which means that wherever we see a variable placeholder x, we're going to replace that x with an x plus a. That's totally different than f of x plus a, which would just add a plus a onto the end of a function. Details, small but critical. So let's find f of x plus a. Go ahead, pause, and try that on your own. We replace the x with an x plus a, and we get 3 times quantity x plus a minus 10, which simplifies to 3x plus 3a minus 10. G of x plus a will be the square root of quantity x plus a minus 1. Now the division part, which is actually the easiest part. We divide our two outputs. With all of the variables, there's not much we can do to simplify. Depending on your teacher's preferences, they may wish you to leave your function as it is written here, or they might want you to rationalize the denominator to remove the square root. At the pre-calculus level, I prefer to see the function with the square root in the denominator, as it will help simplify several different things we do with functions in this course. Make sure you ask your teacher what they like and want. Now we have the hang of finding outputs, let's talk more about the inputs. The domain of a function is the set of all input values of a function. These are typically x values. How you can tell is with the notation. If you have an f of x, the of x part means that you have a function with input x. You may think that we can plug in whatever we want, but that's not always the case. It depends on the function formula. There are some errors that could pop up depending on what the formula contains. Here are the errors we want to avoid. First, division by zero. Second, the even root of a negative number. Third, and finally, taking the logarithm of zero or a negative number. Not every function is going to have all three of these issues, but it may have a combination of different issues to take into account. We will approach this systematically by working our way down this list. Next, we have range. The range is the set of all output values of a function, which are typically the y values on a graph. Let's practice writing the domain and range values for a simple function f of 3 points. Our 3 points are 1, 2, 3, 3, and negative 1, 2. The domain is the list of all x values, 1, 3, and negative 1. Don't forget to add the set braces. Lastly, order doesn't matter when you're listing domain and range. The range is the list of all y values. Go ahead and list that out. You should get 2 and 3. Let's go on to some more complicated examples. Please notice that I'm intentionally not going to discuss the range of these functions. We will learn how to do that in a future video after we cover some necessary information. We are not ready for it yet. We will find the domain of the following functions. First, we find the domain of f of x equals 3x minus 10 over 2x squared minus 18. We zone right in on the problems that could happen with this formula. The numerator is irrelevant to us, so we ignore it. We see that we have division, so we must discard x values that cause division by zero. We must find when 2x squared minus 18 is equal to zero. Pause the video and see if you can solve that equation. We factor this by pulling out the common factor 2 and noticing that we have a difference of squares left. The x squared minus 9 factors as x minus 3 times x plus 3. So our bad x values are plus 3 and minus 3. There are no even roots or logarithms, so we don't have to worry about those issues. So we put all of our x values on the number line and we get all real numbers except negative 3 and 3, which in interval notation would be negative infinity to negative 3, union negative 3 to 3, union 3 to infinity, all in parentheses. If this is a little foggy, make sure to re-watch my video covering interval notation. Moving on to our next example, g of x equals 3x plus 1 over the square root of 2x minus 5. We see a combination of possible issues here because we have a division and an even root. We know that the 2x minus 5 must be greater than or equal to 0 in order to square root it, but because it's in the denominator of a fraction, we can't have the square root of 0 in the denominator of the fraction. This means that 2x minus 5 must be strictly greater than 0. This is a basic linear inequality, so go ahead and see if you can solve it. pause that video, and when you figure it out, come back. So we can isolate the x using our basic operations, and we get that x must be greater than 5/2. In interval notation, that is 5/2 to infinity in parentheses. One last example, and for this one, I'm cranking up the heat. We are working with the function h of x equal to -1 over the square root of 2x squared minus 18. We have a nonlinear function inside the square root, namely a parabola. Just like in the last example, not only can we not have 0 in the denominator of the fraction, but we can't have a negative inside the square root. So we need to make sure 2x squared minus 18 is strictly greater than 0. We set up this inequality and then have to think carefully about how to solve it. Because it is nonlinear, we cannot solve it by isolating the variable x. Even though it may look like you can do it, if you attempt to do so, you will notice that you don't get the correct values that I get at the end. Because you trust me, perhaps blindly at this point, you want to know how we can solve it. Great question. In upcoming videos, we will learn about the inequality test, a fast chart-based method for solving these inequalities. For now, we will solve by graphing, which is the go-to method for any sort of nonlinear inequality that you are not sure how to handle. It is the single most powerful tool. Okay, enough raving, down to business. We sketch the graph of y equals 2 times x minus 3 times x plus 3, as we saw in the first example that we could factor our quadratic like that. Using some principles of graphing quadratics, we have x-intercepts -3 and 3. To get one more point for this quadratic, we plug in the input x equals 0 and get the point 0, -18. Now we have enough to sketch our parabola. If you are shaky on graphing this parabola, I encourage you to watch my video on sketching quadratics. We will cover it extensively. Now that we have the sketch, we are looking for where the parabola is greater than 0. Visually, that will look like a curve lying about the x-axis. I will shade that in red to highlight it. So the x values that keep this parabola greater than 0 are all x values less than -3 and all x values greater than 3. We don't include the -3 and 3 because those are the x values that give us square root of 0. Remember, we were trying to stay strictly greater than 0. So in interval notation, our domain is -infinity to -3 and 3 to infinity with parentheses. Whew, made it to the end. Before we say goodbye, I want you to notice that for all domain examples in this video, I am purposely using interval notation. This is because it is the convention in my pre-calculus course, and I expect all of my students to master and use interval notation. On that happy note, I say congratulations for becoming an expert on function basics, and make sure to tell your friends all about it.